Diaspora, Collective Abolition, Marginalized Genders and Lessons Learned. Then we're gonna jump into some guidance around what we as Black folks deserve and need from white and non-Black allies. And before we end and wrap up for the night, we're gonna go over some takeaways. So some major highlights, food for afterthought that you can sit and marinate on your own later or chat with other folks, as well as going over some day of actions, collective day actions that are happening statewide on the 7th. All right, so this is who we got on deck. We got some real Black magic happening. We got Nia Adams, Stevie Vargas, Khamisi Black, Callie Jane, myself, Tia Strother, Lumumba Bandele, Jawanza Williams, and Jaleel, who will be here with us in digital spirit. He had to bow out last minute, but he actually took the time today to record a video for us. So he's still gonna be with us. All right, with that said, I'm gonna pass it off to Khamisi, who's gonna frame us in revolution and abolition as it connects to the legacy of Black August. Khamisi, you ready to pop off?
Yeah, girl.
Hi.
Hi, everyone. How y'all doing tonight? Happy Black August. It's my favorite month of the year, let me tell you. When we talk about what is Black August, when we examine its principles, two quotes come to my mind. One being that it is a time to embrace the principles of unity, self-sacrifice, political education, physical training, and resistance, said by Sundiata Tate, one of the San Quentin Six. The other is that it's a month of divine meeting, of repression and radical resistance, of injustice and divine justice, of righteous rebellion, of individual and collective efforts to free the slaves and break the chains that bind us. Also said by another political prisoner, Mumia Abdul-Jamal. When we actually examine Black August, it was enacted in 1979 within the California prison system, specifically San Quentin, to commemorate the deaths of brothers Jonathan and George Jackson, who gave their lives in 1970 and 71, respectively, in attempts to liberate political prisoners. From there, it grew in its first years to include the sacrifices and struggles by all Black and African people throughout history and the breadth of the Black diaspora, many of which, you know, occurred in this month of August. It's the month of study, of unity, of radical resistance, and folks will dig into this timeline in just a few minutes. One thing I do want to emphasize is that Black August is not Black History Month Part 2. While Black History Month aims to, in like a very diluted and capitalistic way, like celebrate this like individual and like even sometimes collective gains and contribution to, like, you know, as they say, like shape the life in the United States, Black August is specifically a commemoration and study of freedom fighters, educating the people on the revolutionary nature of history and actions of continued resistance in the Black and African peoples against oppression, imperialism, colonization, and slavery in the United States. And again, throughout the diaspora, with a particular emphasis again on revolutionaries and historical acts of resistance. Rooted in this this struggle and sacrifice for liberation, the principles of Black August, like she was saying before, do not point us in the direction of reforming a system that exploits and oppresses us or the diversification of our oppressors, right? They steer us towards abolition, not just of the prison industrial complex or the criminal injustice apparatus, but all structures, institutions, and systems that maintain exploitation and oppression over our people, separating ourselves physically and ideologically from these structures, right, in this process. Because, you know, like the quote goes, you know, we can't tear down the master's house or build our own with his tools. And so with this clear understanding of the interconnectedness between race, gender, and class, it's not enough to simply be anti-white supremacy, which of course we all must be, but white supremacy was created and maintained by the capitalist class, as well as the gender divisions that are responsible for patriarchy, and anti-LGBTQI ideology, which, you know, just so contempt amongst ourselves. A movement or revolution centering the principles of Black August must be also militantly anti-capitalist, anti-patriarchy, anti-imperialism, and colonialist, because we cannot afford to recreate or maintain these systems that reproduce hierarchical structures of oppression, right, within our communities. And in rejecting these structures, it has to be anti-patriarchal and feminist, centering and led by all marginalized genders that have historically led the movement for liberation in the first place, right? And of course, our oppressors are not relegated to any one nation. To permanently destroy these oppressive forces, it will require, as George Jackson said, the cooperation and communion between our related parts, the communion between colony and colony, nation and nation. And so our organizing must also be anti-imperialist and build an international solidarity, particularly through this diaspora. And I think I'm like pretty close to my time. And I know we're going to get into like all of this stuff. But I'll just say like lastly, that like the history and the lessons of Black August provide us with a blueprint for revolution, right? We don't have to recreate the wheel. Adapting this blueprint and prioritizing these principles are crucial if we are to continue its legacy of solidarity and resistance and be actually successful in breaking the chains that, you know, Mumia had said before that kept us bound for generations. So, you know, thank you again for coming to this, and I look forward to hearing what everyone else has to say.
Thank you so much, Kamisi. All right, so now we're actually going to jump into a little bit of timeline and historic moments. And we're gonna watch our elder Jaleel, the video that he made for us as he walks us through the birth and the legacy of Black August. So Saye, you ready to cue up that video?
Black August. Black August actually began on August 7th, 1971, when a young Jonathan Jackson went into the Marin County Courthouse to free James McClain and William Christmas. Along came also Rochelle McGee. Keep in mind that Rochelle was not originally part of the plan of Jonathan. He was there petitioning for his own case to be released from prison. And when Jonathan came in and said that he was taking over the courtroom, they asked Rochelle, did he want to come along? And he decided to do so on that fateful day. As you well know, everyone was killed except for Rochelle, the only living survivor of the onslaught by California Correctional Departments and other law enforcement who sought to ensure that they did not get away. Jonathan's efforts was in fact an attempt to release his brother, George. The following year, August 21st, 1971, George was murdered in San Quentin Prison. And it resulted in a long battle inside the prison system in terms of his legacy and them trying to diminish his legacy as a revolutionary. And that was August 21st, 1971. The following week, August 28th, 1971, myself and Noah Washington, Albert James Washington, Noah, was captured. And it was alleged that we were attempting to retaliate against the death of George the following weekend, on the 1st, 21st. Now, what was important to understand is that the history comprising, recognized by the prisoners of California prison system, particularly the Black Miller family, also extends all the way back to Nat Turner's insurrection. It goes back to Marcus Garvey's birth. It goes back to other incidents in history that occurred in the month of August. They're commemorated primarily and originally started with the Black Little family. This was in 1978. when Qatari Jeffrey Golden, who was then at that time, took over the mantle or the leadership of the Black Gorilla family after the demise of, after the assassination of George. And they began to feel the need for them to adhere to a history, to a legacy of resistance, like Jeffrey Golden, like George, like Jonathan, like Marcus, like Nate, the Reverend Nate Turner. And they divided a curriculum of study, fasting, and exercise for the month of August in order to commemorate this history, this legacy of resistance. And I think it's important for us to build upon that legacy, build upon that history. As you well know, our story here in America is one where they have granted us 1 month for Black history. However, that Black history does not necessarily comprise the kind of revolutionary determination as is prominent in Black August. And the ideals of Black August is one of revolutionary resistance. And so we need to hail Black August across the country. It has been going on for 50 years now, and we need to continue it. We need to continue to build upon it as part of continuing our own struggle for liberation and independence. Using Black August is a way for us to revitalize our spirit, revitalize our determination, and understanding that our struggle is from one generation to the next, as has Black August and its existence in the last 50 years. Now, in regards to my own history or contribution to the movement, many know that I was organizing the Black Panther Party. Prior to that, I was an organizer for Black students in my high school. Prior to that, I was a child marcher within NAACP for civil rights along with my mom, which all led to my eventually being recruited into the Black Underground, which was being known as the BLA. The name of the BLA didn't come prominent until after my arrest, or actually it came into existence at the time of my particular incident for which I was convicted of. That was on May 19th and May 21st. May 19th was two police officers was shot, not killed, and Nuruddin bin Wahab was charged with it, and ultimately after 19 years, was acquitted, or was had his conviction reversed and released from prison. May 21st, two officers was also killed. It was, 2 days, 3 days later. And someone, and I don't know who, sent out a letter to the news media informing that it was the act of the BLA for retaliation of some young people who were murdered by the police at that time. After I was arrested in August 1971, eventually convicted for activities that happened in California and activities that happened in
So I think the video got cut off, but that was our elder Jaleel talking about the legacy and struggles around Black August. And now we're actually gonna have Lumumba Bandele walk us through a little bit more of Black August history. So we talked about 1979 and the birth of Black August. We talked about the fallen ancestors and comrades who were fighting the fight. And now we're gonna talk about some more historical moments. Lumumba, take it away.
Thank you, thank you. I just wanna actually back up and just make sure people know why we actually had Baba Jaleel Mutakim on here and his significance. It was assumed that most people know, but Jaleel Mutakim comes out of the Black Panther Party and was one of the longest held, at least in New York, political prisoners. He was incarcerated in 1971 and was just released in the fall of 2020. So I want you to get a sense of almost 50 years this man spent time in prison because of his work as a revolutionary, because of his work in both the Black Panther Party and, as he stated, as a member in the Black Liberation Army. And so the idea that we actually have him home, the idea that he is alive, that he's vibrant, he's excited and he's all over the place. You know, if he didn't triple book, he would have been here on this panel with us, is a blessing. And so we are thankful that he continues to do the work, and he is a reflection of the spirit and the elements of Black August. So that's one of the reasons why he was asked to join us. So thank you for Tia for pulling him into the space. So like we said, Black August is not Black history. Thank you, Kamisi, for doubling down on that. Thank you, Baba Jalil, for tripling down on that. Like, we want to be really clear that there is a distinction, right? And so there's some things that happened within the month of August that we use as anchors to remind us of the purpose and function of Black August. We are here in this particular moment in space and time to reflect on our resistance movement, on our legacy of continuing to fight for freedom. And I always say that since the Europeans touched the shores of the continent of Africa and attempted to kidnap us, we have never stopped fighting. We have never stopped fighting. And so a few dates for us to remember. Our people were enslaved. You know, the numbers are, of course, inconceivable. So we know that in 1619 was when the first Black bodies were brought over in chains into the what was then called, what we now know as the United States of America, but was then Turtle Island. We know that in 1791, Haitian revolutionaries did the damn thing, right? We know that that particular act of the Haitian Revolution was one that began a process of, in that hemisphere, helping to encourage other uprisings. And not only did they do that in Haiti, but they were also shipped to other parts of the diaspora. There's this very rich history of Haitian revolutionary fighters who were sent to Louisiana to help encourage and help to support the uprisings that were planned there. So that happened in August. And then we know that in the 1800s, the Underground Railroad was born. And so we know that there's a series of other activities that have happened throughout the month of August. And so we reflect on those. We know that a major part of Black August is studying. This is the time where we actually do in-depth study about that. What happened in the Haitian Revolution? What happened with the establishment of the Underground Railroad? All of those things are a real important part of our history and our reflection in the spirit of Black August.
Thank you, Lumumba. All right, so now it's time for some of our Black folks to talk some shit together. We're gonna have our first panel discussion. Now I'm gonna give y'all a disclaimer. This is not some respectable formalized panel, and this ain't no fireside chat. This is some real talk amongst Black folks. So Nia is gonna lead us and our panelists in a conversation about the Black diaspora and collective abolition. You ready, Nia? You ready, yes. Girl? Time to get
it. I'm ready. Thank you. Hello, everybody. My name is Nia, she, her. Very honored to be in this space with some really dope-ass revolutionaries. And this is one of my favorite topics, right, is like a Pan-Africanist view of our collective struggle and our collective liberation. So we're going to chit-chat a little bit, and I appreciate Lumumba doing that timeline, because Black August, again, although informed by history, is not a Black History Month, right? And so we need to be mindful that this is about decolonization, study, discipline, armed struggle, radical resistance, and rebellion. So to kick that off, right? I would love to talk a little bit more about global Black struggles, right? So we have rebellions and revolutions throughout the diaspora. Although by contrary, they will have us believe that white men in offices signed pieces of paper that emancipated us versus the fact that we were burning down plantations and demanding our freedom from Git, right? So before we jump into that, just gonna mention a couple so that we can get comfortable in the space, right? So, you know, we have obviously one of the resistance groups people are most familiar with in the United States is the Black Panther Party and the Black Revolutionary Army. We have the British Black Panthers who fought a lot for Black Caribbean and African folks in the UK. The Young Lords, which models a lot of their self after the Black Panthers, but largely an Afro-Puerto Rican, Black Puerto Rican, Black Boricuas, right? Thomas Sankara out of Burkina Faso. You have the Grenadian Revolution in the 70s. And so I would love to hear from some of these dope revolutionaries about their thoughts about that and what that means as it relates to the dyad, our collective liberation.
Mm-hmm. I'll jump in and let folks chime in as well. I think what's important is that when we talk about our liberation struggle, our liberation struggle was never exclusively limited to one geographic space. We were always fighting for the freedom of Africans at home and abroad, as Marcus Garvey said. We always wanted to make sure that Africans, wherever they were on this globe, were free. And it's important that it wasn't just a ideological kind of connection, but it was very much practical. So when we talk about the Grenadian Revolution, as you raised, the Grenadian Revolution was supported by many people here in the United States. You know, we know of organizations like the East, Black United Front, who worked very closely with the New Jewel Movement and were very close with Maurice Bishop's father and Maurice Bishop. You know, I remember my parents traveling to Grenada just only months before the invasion. So we have these connections. We know that, in fact, there are some people who are currently political prisoners. One of their charges were actually helping to support the freedom fighters in Zimbabwe by expropriating money from here in the United States and sending it to Zimbabwe, right? We know that our struggles have always been connected, again, not just ideologically, but practically. We make sure we keep ourselves, you know, lifted and supported. So this idea of a global freedom kind of manifestation is very much a part of our historical reality.
Absolutely. And it's one of my favorite topics because I am a Grenadian American. My mother born in Grenada and was there during the revolution. And, you know, speaking very explicitly about the fact that this was an English-speaking Black nation that took control and the threat that that caused to the United States. So why Reagan felt it was so important to descend on us, right? Is that you cannot be inspiring these other, as if any Black people need to be inspired to be free, first of all. Okay, because that's the whole thing when we talk about, you know, the Haitian Revolution is obviously, but don't think that people in the US weren't burning down their plantations and plotting as well. We are Black by the reality of being displaced, you know, enslaved and displaced, right? And so this collective struggle, it's very interesting to think about not just the relationships between the US and Grenada. And I recently learned about a documentary, The House on Cocoa Street, right? And seen a clip of the Honorable Angela Davis, who we need to be mindful that our elders are still here with us. This is not a past memory of long ago. But how she speaks about her experience in Revolutionary Grenada, right? But that our struggles were also connected to those of African nations being liberated, to the Palestinian people, to those in occupied Puerto Rico. And so, Stevie, you know I'm gonna pivot to you to give us the tea, girl.
I'll reiterate what Tia said. Like, again, like this, what we're talking about is deeply personal. So if I get teary eyed, it is what it is. Because no matter where we are, Puerto Ricans are extremely prideful. And I want to talk about this three race thing that, you know, a lot of our people like to perpetuate. Not all Puerto Ricans are Black, but there are a lot of Black Puerto Ricans. And we do have a lot of white Puerto Ricans who like to co-opt space. We need to be mindful of that. But hearing the history of Black August and Black revolutionaries fighting against colonization and colonialism, it made me deeply emotional because I think of people like Pedro Albizu Campos, a Black Puerto Rican man. I'll say it again, a Black Puerto Rican man who fought against the US occupation. He went to Harvard. They denied him valedictorian because he was a Black Puerto Rican man. He spoke seven languages. Ireland drafted him to help them write their constitution. A Black man of the diaspora. He was the one who ordered people like Lolita LeBron and Miranda to storm Congress, storm the Capitol back in the 50s. So these four people went in, they sat in there, and they opened fire, 30 shots. They unfurled the Puerto Rican flag and they said, a free Puerto Rico. And Lolita even said, she was like, I did not come here to kill anybody. I came here to die for Puerto Rico. And I am a diaspora Boricua. I'm a Black Boricua. I will always acknowledge that I'm ambiguous. I do not have the same experiences as my mother. My identity with Blackness is different. My experience with Blackness is different. But I was raised by a Black mama, so I got Black politics. and so when we talk about liberation for Puerto Rico, we're still talking about it right now because we're still occupied. And the US is actively killing our people. You can go. Is actively killing our people. We saw the response to Hurricane Maria. We saw how they treated our people. We see how they're treating our education system. Charter schools are running rampant. Children cannot get to school. They are selling our land to luxury retreats so that wealthy white people can come and vacation while our people are dying. We don't have access to hospitals, and it deeply impacts Black Puerto Ricans. I also think about how the US initiated a gag law where it was a federal crime to talk about our identity, to talk about our pride, any of that. We were sentenced to prison. They indoctrinated our schools. They would not let us speak our language. I think of the Ponce massacre where the US government came into our community and wounded over 200 people and killed many who were fighting for liberation. And they marched into Ponce, which was predominantly Black. So we have two areas in Puerto Rico that are predominantly Black. That's Loíza and Ponce, where a lot of the fight for liberation is. And our government, not our government, actually. Let me walk that back. It's not our government.
It's not ours either. I don't subscribe.
When I'm on this land, because I was born in the U.S., I fight for Black liberation, but when I talk about Puerto Rico, I am not American. U.S. citizenship was imposed on our people. It was forced down our throats. We are actively fighting for our liberation, something that a lot of us are willing to die for. So to anyone who might be in this space, again, you're a guest, and you might see the eye of my eye when I talk about how they stormed the Capitol and they opened fire. Yes, I am fucking gleeful about it. And it is not similar to what happened on January 6th. It is very different.
That part. And let's talk about armed struggle. Okay, so first of all, rest in power to George Jackson, right? And if you have not read Blood in My Eye, you need to. At the core of Black August is abolition of the carceral state, because we understand that you know, a lot of times we talk about mass incarceration, it's related to the crime bill of the 90s. That's not true. The carceral state comes straight out of chattel slavery, which was an international human trafficking scheme that benefit imperialists. So when we're talking about Black August, we're talking about anti-imperialism, anti-colonialism, and the abolishment of carceral systems, which steal our labor and exploit us and kill us quite literally. And so I'm interested, and we only have a few minutes left in this panel section, so don't get too hype, about y'all's thoughts about the dismantling of the carceral state, specifically now, because we've seen in the last year during the pandemic, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd, a nationwide, really a global uprising for Black lives, and in many ways have been co-opted by non-Black folks to be a more respectable movement, but we know what it is. So what are y'all thoughts on the dismantling of the carceral state? And I'm gonna just jump in and say, and Black solidarity movements.
I mean, I guess I'll jump in on this. I'm Callie, I use they, them pronouns. You know, I think that as we talk about dismantling the carceral state, we really need to be thinking about all the alternatives as well. So we can't just be thinking about the shit we need to tear down, because yeah, we need to tear down shit. We know what that shit is. And like, there were folks when we were trying to abolish slavery that were like, we can't abolish things. Like, this is the way it is. How would we do it? Like, how would we continue to keep our rule and dominate other people? And those are the same fucking conversations that are happening right now as we're talking about abolition. But I think that a lot of what we do need to do is be thinking about what we are going to replace this with. You know, how are we going to, you know, handle and grow in our community? How are we going to center things in love and community care versus, you know, this need for revenge and throwing people in cages? You know, and so I think that as we're talking about dismantling the state, we have to be very clear that our goal is to not have dismantling the whole state. I said carceral state, but you know, maybe the whole state. Let's just go. Maybe we could take over the world, first the bank. Okay. But I think that, you know, we really got to be, you know, looking and making sure that our long-term goal is always like, you know, removing police, removing any need to throw somebody in a cage, you know, and that we are instead looking at all the different alternatives for that.
Thank you. And let's be real. We put, and when I say we, I don't mean us, but our oppressors put trillions of dollars into the carceral state instead of youth services, mental, emotional health services, healthcare, housing, education. I mean, literally they are invested in putting us into cages and exploiting our bodies and our labor. And it's unacceptable. And we got to stop acting also as if we always lived in a carceral state, as if this is the only way to live. People are scared to abolish the police, but guess what? It's very scary to live in a carceral state. I think that shit's scarier. But let me not get on my soapbox, because I know we have a full agenda. So I'm going to pass it to my comrade, Jawanza.
So before we pass it off, Jawanza, if you could hold for a moment, I want to give us maybe about 10 seconds to hear from our powerful, dope-ass motherfucking ancestor, Nina Simone. But it just felt fitting. You just plain rotten. You're too damn lazy. Thinking it's crazy. Can I do it? What am I doing? I don't know. I don't know. It's time to do your very best. Stand up, be counted with all the rest. For everybody knows about Mississippi Top. Yeah. Alright. Jawanza, it's all you, boo. Take us through the next couple of moments in the historic timeline of Black August.
Sure. So first, I just want to say deeply appreciate Lumumba, Jaleel, Nia, and first person who spoke. And I just, whose name is eluding me at this moment. And my name is Jawanza, I use he, him pronouns. And I just want to briefly talk about two pivotal moments that happened in the 1960s. And honestly, just be totally transparent that I'm really here as a student. I'm really trying to understand the distinctions of Black August and, you know, some of these sort of critical events that happened. So really, I probably shouldn't be on a panel, But I do know that there are some sort of thematic things that we can pull out that sort of seem to be consistent along the lines of sort of revolutionary struggle and Black liberation. And before I move there, I do want to say about the previous panel discussion about abolition. I think there's a lot of things that we have to hold, a lot of complexities that we have to hold about this most recent period, the most recent uprising in 2020, connected to the murder of George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and all the other people that were stolen from us in that most recent period, is that the defund the police sort of campaign is not antithetical to abolition, but it is not necessarily immediately abolitionist. So I think that sometimes people get very confused when we're talking about the sort of reforms or sort of moves towards quote progress. I think that sometimes things can be antithetical to abolition, and that's if they are expanding and maintaining and securing the carceral state. But if something is reducing the power and the scope of the carceral state or of the police, for instance, then it is on an abolitionist track. And because I feel like a lot of times I heard people, and this is a thing that we could debate, and perhaps this is a thing that comes up in upcoming panels, is this idea that defund the police or this call to defund the police is not abolitionist. And I think that there was a tension and a struggle that I noticed and was aware of, at least in New York City last year, during our sort of collective movement to defund and ultimately dismantle the NYPD. So there's that. And I think that that brings me directly to the first thing that I want to name from the 1960s, which happened on August 11th in 1965, which was the Watts Rebellion in South Central Los Angeles, where, you know, a family of Black folks, well, one Black man was stopped and pulled over, but ultimately him, his brother, and his mom were arrested and brutalized by the police. And that led to a mass uprising that resulted in over 34 people being killed, 1,000 people being injured, under extreme police repression and violence. And, you know, lots of buildings were burned down. So there's these iconic images that you see of like buildings burning, et cetera. And I think that what's core for us to take away, you know, as we set the stage for the next panel discussion, is not that somehow, and I think to, I need to get this other panelist's name correct. Okay, Kamisi, that's who I was trying to name earlier. Thank you, sorry about that. But as Kamisi was saying earlier, or a lot of what they were saying reminded me of the fact that in a sort of Black History Month context or sort of framework of how to understand Black people's experiences, it's, you know, a riot and all these kinds of things, and somehow about the individual cop and the individual Black people that were abused and brutalized. But in fact, if you really understand, I'm gonna put in the chat now a link to the liberationschool.org article. It's very brief that I use to sort of prepare myself for this conversation that comes from the PSL, the Revolutionary Socialist Organization, that to really understand the context of the Watts Rebellion. It's really about Black people in mass responding to a systemic, structural, and cultural oppression, not just to this individual or isolated situation of police brutality on individuals, but actually a sort of psychic awakening and an uprising, a sort of reminder that we need to respond to these structures and this culture of white supremacist anti-Black violence, which does ultimately lead to annihilation or to like the murder of our people and ultimately to genocide. These are the kind of parts that these things lead to. And what we saw at the Watts uprising was a response to that reality, like we saw last year in 2020. That's why there was so much sort of rioting, quote unquote, looting, quote unquote. And then the sort of like liberal or conservative or centrist perspective, like, oh, look at these people creating property damage and having all these conversations, when really we're talking about the humanity of Black people across the world. And I think that it reminded me, at least, that this is nothing new, what we saw in 2020, that we've been, as Lumumba said, responding in this way from the very beginning. And I think that that's really critical for us to understand about the context of the 1960s. And also another thing that I learned recently is that Malcolm X had actually recently spoken a couple of months before the Watts uprising happened in Watts and was murdered shortly before that, assassinated. And so all of this energy, all of this movement work is all these points are what led to that moment, not just the individual police occurrence, which tells me as an organizer, as a person interested in building movements, that that energy, that reality, because of the oppression is always there, that we can tap back into that at any moment. It's just a matter of how we get there. And I think that's one of the reasons why this entire teaching is actually happening. And that's why I really appreciate it. And also, of course, I don't want to spend too much more time here, is the 1960s, you know, the marches on Washington that happened in August, where, you know, we saw Black people and our supposed allies and accomplices really moving to action and flooding the streets in ways that could not be ignored, and in very powerful displays of popular energy and demand. So I'll pause there, Tia.
All right. Thank you, Jawanza. So actually, the ending on the March on Washington is a perfect segue to talking to our next panel, which Callie and Kamisi are gonna lead around centering marginalized genders, because there's a lot of invisible Black bitches who threw down to make the March on Washington happen. And their names are not, you know, always put at the forefront of history when we're talking about this. You know, everybody wanna, you know, big up to MLK, not taking no shine from my brother. But like, there's a lot of Black women who was in the kitchens putting together sandwiches for motherfuckers to make sure everybody could eat. There was, you know, Black women making sure that motherfuckers had transportation to get there, making sure that people were safe, like holding it down, doing childcare off on the side. So I feel like that was a perfect segue to talking about how we center marginalized genders, and also how historically that has not always happened, right? So Callie and Kamisi are gonna pop off in this conversation. But before that happens, I wanna take a moment, and I hope that all of you as our guests and participants, you know, join in on this through the chat. I just wanted to take a moment of appreciation and just marvel at the brilliance and the dopeness of all of our speakers so far. Like, this shit has been popping. We still got some time to go, and I have no doubt that it's gonna continue to pop off. And like, y'all doing the damn thing right now. And you know, I gotta give y'all a little Prince tribute right now, cause baby, y'all are stars. Y'all niggas are stars tonight.
We love you. And thank you. You a star.
All right, Kamisi, Callie, y'all ready to take it?
Yeah. Hey, y'all.
Hi.
Oh, man. All we need is for you to gas us up all the time. That's amazing. That's amazing. You know, I was trying to think about like where to start in this, you know, and, you know, I figured that we would start with talking about the book, How We Get Free, Black Feminism and the Combahee River Collective, right? You know, and Dr. Kianga Yamada Taylor says, you know, that you always need to ally yourself with those on the bottom, on the margins and at the periphery of the centers of power. And in doing so, you will land yourself at the very center of some of the most important struggles of our society and our history. You know, when we talk about the Combahee River Collective, for folks who don't know, because we are doing our edumacation tonight, you know, like, it is a Black feminist lesbian organization really active in the late 70s, between 74 and 80, and really formed because the feminist movement and the civil rights movement were not actually incorporating Black women in the way that they needed to, and marginalized genders. And so they organized that based on the action of at the Combahee River that was organized by Harriet Tubman back in 1863. And so, you know, we are always, a lot of times these movements are ignoring the intersections and are not focusing on those who are really most impacted. And we are not free unless we are all free. Black women are free. If women are free, but Black women are not free, we're not free. If women are free, but trans women are not free, we are not free, you know? And so we need to be bold about that. And that's what's really important in this movement right now, is to center that on the concepts of radical Black feminism, you know, and really looking at the fact that if you know, Black folks, Black mages, marginalized genders, we have the non-Martian clause up in our spot, though, you know, we can't just come in here with all these words if we actually want to educate and then build, right? So if Black mages are not, are free, then everyone else will be free. But that's going to require the breakdown of all of the political economic systems like capitalism and imperialism and all of that. And so we need to be listening to those voices and uplifting them. And yeah, I guess I'll stop there for a second, pass it to Kamisi, and then open it up for other folks to talk about it too.
helps if I unmute. There we go. Yeah, no, you know, just you know, to just build off of that, you know, when we generally talk about like revolutions and revolutionary struggle, Black women and marginalized genders end up being like cast in these like support roles when we reflect on these events and movements, or like administrative roles, right? Like they were like the secretary of like SNCC or something along those lines. But I think, you know, when you look at that struggle, again, across the diaspora, whether it's like Cecil Fatima and Sanité Blair in Haiti, or Queen Nanny in Jamaica, or Claudia Jones in Trinidad, or, you know, Marianne Shedd and Harriet Tubman, Miss Major, Audre Lorde, Marsha P. Johnson, like, we've always been on the revolutionary forefront of struggle, you know, both ideologically helping shape the narrative that, you know, creates, you know, the banner that we fight under, and physically, right? Like they weren't just relegated to like speaking portions like you had with the Adelitas in Mexico, right? Women actually picking up guns and fighting alongside men in order to get, you know, liberation. Same thing in Haiti, same thing in Cuba, same thing in Venezuela. All of these places that touch the Black diaspora. Same thing in South Africa. And so, you know, if we are going to shift this narrative away from, you know, these like cis heteronormative patriarchal retellings of like our own history, we have to prioritize that centering of, you know, Black mages. That have, you know, always been on the forefront and in the leadership to liberate all of us. Because like Callie said, when you lift, you know, if Black marginalized people are free, then by definition, we all have to be free, right? So like you can't, you know, free everybody unless you're lifting from that bottom. So yeah, I want to like open it up to like everyone else too. Like, you know, how does this like influence like your organizing? What struggles do you see in like centering, you know, Black mages and like real like revolutionary like organizing?
I'll jump in. So it's incredibly important. Maybe the most important part of organizing is centering Black marginalized genders. One of the most devastating aspects put onto us through global chattel slavery, right, was the introduction of white patriarchy. And so this idea when we, one, did not live like that, and two, we know that our survival as Black people through the diaspora has largely been because of Black marginalized genders. It's been because of these kinship bands that we have created out of survival. It has been Black women, armed Black women, even if you're talking about, I mean, Black August and the Jackson brothers, Jonathan stormed that courthouse with guns that were registered to Angela Davis, okay? Like Black women and marginalized genders in general are in the front, literal front lines. If at protests, it was, you know, again, Stevie, if we're talking about the Daniel Prude uprisings in Rochester last year, it was young Black marginalized genders, literally front line, getting fucked up by the police to protect those behind us, right? And so there's absolutely no way, there's no way, and y'all hear it all the time, particularly after the murder of Breonna Taylor, which I've continued to struggle with since last March, that y'all play that audio of Malcolm X, the most disrespected person in the United States, in America, is the Black woman. Y'all say it, y'all don't live it. Y'all don't protect Black women. Y'all try to erase us. And it's a problem because we gotta also stop acting like there aren't foxes in the hen house, like they ain't issues inside the house. I got a lot of feelings about it. But it happens.
No, I think that's so important. Thank you for saying that. Now go ahead, who's gonna go?
Oh, it's Tia, sorry. So I'm supposed to be playing a strictly MC role and leaving y'all to it, but Nia done triggered me and shit. So I wanna jump in real quick. And I actually wanna ask Lumumba, as someone, you know, cause all of us are young niggas, right? And Lumumba, you know, he's been in the shit for a minute. And I'm curious about like your experiences and perspective around like, you know, patriarchy and misogyny showing up in movements in the past. And like, if that's anything that, you know, you can speak on, I'm curious about like, less like shit.
No, I'm interested too, because, no. You know, we know like someone like the Honorable Asada Shakur left certain spaces because of patriarchy.
Right.
And it doesn't mean that shit wasn't getting done, but it also means that we have shit to work on that was informed, that white people gave us. It wasn't ours to have, but white people gave us, and we need to reject it.
Facts. We got to clean the dust out of our houses. And Lumumba is married to a powerful Black woman. You know, so I'm just curious if you could, you know, if you want to jump in real quick. Don't take up too much space, homie.
No. So you mentioned Asada Shakur. I'll mention some ancestors. Safiyu Bukhari, Nahanda Abiodun, Janet Searle. These are only three ancestors, Black women, revolutionary, radical, militant leaders who impacted my life, who I know I learned from. In fact, challenged me to make sure I didn't make some of the same mistakes that some of my male elders made. We know, I mean, it's absolutely clear that particularly young cis Black men have inherited some very fucked up politics, practices, right? And I'm really proud when I see other people, younger generations, who are putting that on its head, who are really centering Black women, who are centering femmes, centering LGBTQ folks, like in a real way, not just like ideologically, but like are stepping back, like shutting up and stepping back and actually elevating when it's necessary to do that as well. So there's no question, have I seen it? Yes. Have I lived it? Yes. I come out of a very traditional militant Pan-African family and organization. There's no question. We're always reflecting now on how jacked up it was and how we actually have the responsibility now to make sure that we don't replicate some of those mistakes.
Yeah, and I'm gonna jump in for a second and say like how jacked up it is too. But like, thank you for saying that, because I think that like we're still having these conversations in the everyday movements now and trying to, you know, where people are trying to prioritize cis Black men, you know, over the contributions of women and mages, telling folks to know their place and know their space and to, you know, where, you know, just like show up and like, you know, the pick me's and all that, you know. And I guess I, like in this moment, I just like want to shout out, you know, a lot of learning I've been doing, because I feel too, I'm here as a student, you know, and reading a lot of bell hooks. You know, and bell hooks talks about, you know, just like this concept of just domination in general, and that, you know, Black men were like, okay, well, I can be like the white man, you know, and like that's what brought in that patriarchal mindset. And then, you know, Black women, I can be like the white woman, you know. But either way, you know, if that's what you're going for, you are still pushing for a culture where you are dominating somebody else. You know, and then we can go even further, like we are setting our children up to that for that from the jump, if we're like doing that whole because I said so thing. But we don't have time for that conversation right now. But you know, as we talk about like bell hooks really talks about, you know, masculinity and feminism and the way that it needs to be, you know, brought into our movements. And we are still seeing that violence here. When I read that the Combahee River you know, collective book that I just, you know, quoted from before, you know, I was like, this could have been written yesterday. Like this literally could have been written yesterday, because these niggas still out here like trying to come after us, you know, in this way. And I just think that like, when I think of like the number of people like in my inbox, like you got to focus on the Black shit, not the queer shit. Like there's not like queer Black people, or like, you know, the Black shit, not the woman shit. It's like Black men, the feminism is the attack on the Black man. Like, what is this nonsense? So like, I'm here, glad we're here doing this edumacation. And I'll also shout out Success Stories, which is a group that we work with. They were formed out of the prisons out in California, and they do a lot of feminism work using bell hooks, books and we work closely with them on our Black Liberation Freedom Fellowship here. And so like that's part of the work too, is like getting folks to understand, because like patriarchy doesn't just hurt women, you know, misogynoir doesn't just hurt Black women, you know, like that is the reason why, you know, we don't, if we can't handle conflict, if, you know, our priority, we say our priorities are our families, but someone calls me a bitch, and so therefore I gotta come out here, you know, that shows up in the movement spaces every day. And you cannot, you know, have a woman tell you what to do when a woman doesn't know their place. So, you know, there's work we gotta do to get all this stuff done. Yeah, so I'll pause there because I could go.
Callie, I appreciate you speaking very, this is a short comment, but specifically in the ways in which people try to silo our identities in the sense of like, I have to be a pro-Black or I have to be a feminist, and I'm never only a woman or only Black. I am a Black woman. I'm a Black marginalized gender. And so we know that either of those movements in a vacuum don't serve me or anyone who's more marginalized than myself. And so it is very important that we decolonize that and work for our collective liberation. But as Jawanza, I think he was going to speak.
Yeah, thank you, Nia. I think I also just want to add a lot to what Callie is saying, just about the importance of the Combahee River Collective statement and how prescient it is, because one of the things that I'm always thinking about as sort of cisgender, even though gay, but male, is this idea about how do I make sure that people understand the modalities of analysis that we're using that comes from Black feminists, and then trying to integrate that into my own political education programming. So for instance, at where I work, my day job, the organization Vocal New York, we have like a leadership development training program called Power Academy. And I know with a lot of the new folks, even one person that's on this call right now, Selena Trowell, who's our homeless union organizer, and another colleague I had, Tatiana Hill, both Black women, we work to really transform that curriculum from before to really account for these new concepts and really help introduce our membership, who are mostly Black and brown, into like developing a sort of critical analysis that accounts for these facts, so that we can start to have conversations about not just how you ideologically understand an issue, but how you behave. And I think that without, for me especially, I can speak for myself, without you know, these voices like Bell Hooks and Angela Davis and you know, documents like the Combahee River Collective, I don't think that I would be able to move as well as I've been able to politically without as causing as much harm. Not to suggest that I haven't caused harm, but I know for a fact that without those tools and really being aware of them and then sort of holding a feminist politic and sort of contending with myself with that, which I can tell you for a long time, especially when we're talking about the sort of gender expansiveness and sort of range of gender and understanding gender, is not easy unless, and here's where I'll pause, unless you're actually in community with people who are of who are gender variant, who are women, who are feminine, who use many pronouns, et cetera. That transformation, which is what really I feel like organizing is all about, is like, how do you create the conditions for transformation? Not simply how do you dismantle the prison, but how do you transform the people so that we don't have the same kinds of violence that we're already responding to, or that the state has responded to in this way, that we want to respond to in another way, as was saying, being said earlier also by Callie, like, what are we going to build up? It's also about building up this sort of worldview, this sort of orientation that I think feminism, Black feminist thought and practice is a vehicle for us to get to the kind of conditions with the kind of people that allows for us to have a society without these carceral systems that are predicated on this safety, as Angela Davis would call it, carceral feminism.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks so much for saying all of that, because it is like we have to be looking at that, the buildup, and as we are talking about abolitionists, like we have to abolish the cop in our heads as well. You know, we need to think about how we are going to handle things differently in order to create this new world that we want to build. Getting a 2-minute thing. So just want to jump up and see who wants to jump in right now and talk a little bit about, you know, the importance of, you know, being grounded in dismantling misogyny within our liberation movements, how that connects to Black August. Everyone acting like they shine now.
I mean, look at the Olympics. Look at Sha'Carri. Look at all of the imperial countries who are very anti-Black, and they are winning off of the backs of the Black people in their country. Spain has Black folks running for them. Amsterdam, Italy? Like, I don't know if y'all ever met European Italians. They do not like Black folks. And of course,
Wait, hold on. They don't like Black folks and they fetishize Black women.
Of course. Yes, because you are a unicorn. That's a whole other thing to dive into. Lord.
Thank you for bringing that up.
I actually just want to mention another name that, I'm sorry if I cut somebody off. Yeah, I just want to mention another name because when we talk about the stories of particularly Black women that need to be lifted up, and I mentioned some names that some people may not be familiar with, I want to share that also there's also experiences in history of Black queer men who participated in our armed struggle that we need to make sure we lift up. You know, I say the name of Kwesi Balogun often. This is somebody who put in the work for real. You know, he's one of the folks that we failed in that we were not able to bring him home. He died in prison. But he was an openly queer revolutionary man in the Black Liberation Army, you know, in the Panthers. And so we want to be real clear about the existence of those experiences of folks in there and the struggle.
And though I want to pause for just 1 second, because I feel like in this moment, as we're talking about like centering like Black women and marginalized genders in this moment, that I do just want to highlight that it, you know, feels so weird to be like, there were men too. Like, we know there were men, but right now I feel like we're talking about like the women. And I feel like that's like a really important just like moment to just like address that, like when we are trying to in one moment center Black women and Black marginalized genders, like we don't need to talk about the men in that moment. And I know we're out of time, so I'm gonna leave it like that. And you know, all respect and love to fam, but you know, it's real.
Mm-hmm. Listen, if you wanna take 30 seconds to call some shit out, go ahead. I'll give you them 30 seconds.
Call in with love. I said what I need to say, you know, like we are not perfect. Nobody is perfect as human beings, and we're gonna say shit, but like we got to talk about it. So
word, thank you. All right, so that's a perfect note to move us to the next discussion. We're gonna talk about the lessons learned from Black August that move us forward. So everything we discussed here, everything we know or have learned about Black August, how is that relevant to our movements and our work today? How does that legacy, those lessons, drive us forward in continuing to build upon what has already existed, what has come before us, and also improve and tweak and figure out and fix and check all that? So word on the street is that Jawanza is going to take us through some lessons learned, and there's nobody better than Craig Mack to actually embody that, because we about to give y'all some flavor in y'all ear. Kicking new flavor, nigga.
1,000 degrees. You'll be on your knees. You'll be burning, begging, please.
Oh, begging, please. All right, Jawanza, we begging, please. Let's talk about these lessons learned.
Yeah, so thank you, Tia. And I definitely appreciate that moment of tension that we just experienced with Kali and Lumumba. And I think that that's one of the lessons that we've learned from this education session. You know, I don't want to repeat it since we've been there, but essentially, you know, it's okay to have a space to talk simply about the contributions of Black women and femmes in a society and in our movement work towards liberation. And I think that it's important for us to be able to move and hold that. So really here, I'm also just wanting to facilitate a conversation because I'm really in a very much absorbing kind of student moment. I've learned a lot. And, you know, primarily is that this history of Black August is very old, that it's this energy that lives in this month and sort of in this resistance that we can point to at very pivotal moments throughout the sort of diasporic histories that, you know, point to the ways in which we've always been resisting and sort of deepening our ability to be resistant. You know, one of the things that I do want to pull out again about Angela Davis, I know she comes up a lot, but she's so beloved and so integral to our ability to build the movements that we have today are absolutely reflective of so much of her work. I know I can say with confidence is that I've heard her say in a number of lectures that whenever we're talking about, whenever young people ask Angela Davis today, like, well, what should we be doing differently? And she's like, hey, like, I can't really offer you that because even in my time, we didn't have as developed of analyses and hold as many complexities as folks today are holding. So I'm wondering, and I want to open it up here to the panelists, like, what are some of the complexities that we should be holding given this history of Black August and visions for the future towards Black liberation across the planet?
I mean, I'm gonna just say one line and then like pass it on for a second. But like the fact of the matter is like, we ain't never get shit by asking nicely, right? So like, I don't want any of this like, oh, well, if you just sit down and why can't you? And that, nah, like we ain't never get shit asking nicely. And that's that. I'm gonna say that.
Thank you. Others?
I mean, at the core of Black August, right, anti-carceral work, abolition, Brother George, we got to think about how he got where he was. This is a teenager that was put into concentration camp, a prison, whatever you want to call it, and sentenced to a year to life for a $70 robbery of a gas station. And so one, what are the systems that allow for us to be that desperate to make those types of moves, right? But the fact that we can invest in the kind of incarceration of Black youth that way. And he did a decolonizing process, right? Like he was reading and learning from other incarcerated revolutionaries. And so at the core, I mean, this is a communist movement. This is, so all your faves are communists and socialists, I promise. And so you can't use that type of language and imagery and not be about that life and then be like, okay, well, let's hold hands and do potlucks with the police. No, that's not what this is about. And we need to stop centering respectability and start centering global Black liberation under racial capitalism, because I promise you, every colonized space has benefited off of stolen indigenous land and stolen labor of enslaved Black folks, what we now call Black folks. So divest from corporations. You're talking about divest from police, divest from corporations. You know, I know a big part of which I have not been participating in Black August is like to fast, right? It's like about fasting and studying and building, being in collective struggle for collective liberation. Finn.
Wow, thank you so much for that, Nia. Like, this is a really profound conversation and really there's a lot of depth on this panel. I'm actually really honored to be here in this space with y'all because I was actually, to be totally frank, very nervous. I was like, well, I don't know. I'm learning about a lot of these things because I've been denied this history. Not that I can't go and find it myself, but to even have a sense of the sort of direction to go. So to your point, Nia, about racial capitalism, I do want to drop Barbara Ransby's name, thinking about, you know, living scholars, activists, leaders that we can look to. Well, really, you know, building out these conversations, having these, you know, opportunities for us to really explore these ideas. So if there's not anybody in, if you weren't looking at the chat, I also asked attendees if you have any comments about lessons learned from Black August. And then Tia put in the chat in questions or comments. Y'all may want us as Black Freedom Project to touch on our subsequent events and sessions and other things that we could be doing. So just let us know so that we can build those things out. And I'm gonna open it again to the panelists if they have any other lessons that we should be holding going forward.
Well, I just want to,
go ahead, Kelly. No, go ahead.
All right, I'll say quickly. I want to respond to something you said about like we don't get to learn this, right? And like throughout the pandemic, you know, I was like kind of homeschooling my kid, like whatever, you know, pandemic schooling my kid. And I was like, oh, like we're supposed to learn about Mount Rushmore. I'm like, oh, we really gonna learn about Mount Rushmore, you know, like. And so it's just like really amazing though to think about the fact that like we don't know a lot of shit. Like our history was like slavery, and then like y'all didn't exist, right? And so like, I remember I sat next to Barbara Smith once from the Combahee River Collective. We were like both speaking at this panel, and I was like, oh, you're on here too. And I'm like, yeah, nice to meet you. We had a sandwich later. I was like, oh, that Barbara Smith. And I was like, I can never let that happen to like another Black person again. Because like, if you sit next to Barbara Smith, you should be picking Barbara Smith's brain, you know? And she is, you know, alive here in the, you know, in New York, and has so much incredible, amazing knowledge of the Combahee River Collective, because like she built it, you know? So just want like shout out Barbara Smith, and the fact that like we got a lot to learn, and that's why we need to create a space where it's okay for people to learn. We can't do this while like knocking on people's doors talking about like the perils of like neoliberal global capitalism. Like that shit ain't gonna work, you know. We gotta like accept people in, because you didn't know what you knew 5 years ago, 10 minutes ago, you know. I got things today that I've just learned right now that I'm gonna go and share with people. And so like we've just got to be really aware of that as we are like building and pushing forward.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I'll add also that one of the things that Black August teaches us is that we need to make sure we take stock of all the tools in our toolbox. That this is not just, you know, this is the month where we talk about resistance. And oftentimes we don't talk about that. When we raise the March on Washington, we know that the advances of the quote unquote civil rights movement were made because people were in the streets kicking ass. We know that those advances were made because people knew that there was an ultimatum. Like either you do this or know that there will be hell in the street. So we need to be real clear about that and understand that we have to be smart about it also, that, you know, in this era of everybody, you know, broadcasting everything, you know, Black August teaches us to move in silence, to move effectively with strategy, with intent. And when we do the study and learn how folks inside moved, you know, with the level of discipline, you know, the California prison systems were scared shitless when folks came in there with their head shaved, wearing black armbands in the cafeteria, silent. Silent, right? So there's a whole lot we can learn from that. And I just wanted to recognize all the different tools we have at our disposal that we must use when it's time to use them.
As an MC and non-panelist, do I have permission to throw out something there real quick? Throw out something to y'all?
Always.
Is there consent? All right, awesome. So to whichever one of you or whoever wants to answer this, when I think about, so Jawanza, you were the first one to name this around like learning, still learning about Black August. And for myself, I didn't learn about Black August till a couple of years ago. And according to some, I'm damn near 40, but if you ask me, I'm closer to 30, whatever. The point is, I spent a large chunk of adulthood not knowing about this until a couple of years ago. So how do you, in the context of the Black August legacy of study and solidarity and awareness and understanding, how do you see the responsibility of our movements now and going forward in bridging the gap between activists, revolutionaries, organizers, and their study of Black August with, you know, the rest of our Black diaspora and communities? How do we bridge and deepen the understanding of these legacies with folks who may not be in these spaces, with folks who, you know, may not know where to go to be able to have this study, or may not have a tribe of folks that they could struggle with and discuss? Like, how do you see the role in our movements in bridging the gap between, you know, those, you know, different levels and different parts of the journey, right, of understanding Black liberation and history?
I mean, we've been talking about this a lot, and I say that, like, it's about creating the space for it. Like, I feel like we have a responsibility to create the space for that. And, like, to be honest, and, like, no shade, but, like, it can't always be a panel. Like, it can't always be a training. Like, it's got to be a barbecue. It's got to be, like, a card game where we can talk about things. Like, so many of the, you know, things I've learned, even when I go away to a training, is, like, the after hours deep conversations about it. And, like, the, well, what do we do when this? And so it's, like, we really got to, like, understand, you know, someone called me an elder the other day. I was like, wait a minute, I don't know what you mean, but like, you know, they're like 19, so I guess whatever. But you know, it's like we have to like create the space of passing on the knowledge. Like we are like responsible for that. Like we can't sit here and talk shit about like, well, wait a minute, like why you still want to call the cops? We know the cops ain't help us, but like, yeah, we know that. And we don't know what else. And we don't know like the depth of it. Like, I don't think I learned about like the prison industrial complex, like, you know, I don't know, like 8 years ago. Like I really got like, oh, I get it now, you know, like, so I just think that we really need to like stop, you know, going back to like abolish the cop in your head. Like we can't look at people and be like, oh, you don't know that, you should know that shit. They don't know that. And like, you know, and then we're done. Like we all need to build and push. And I think that's the only way, like we have a responsibility to create the space for people to learn. Cause we know that like our education system isn't doing it for us. They are not going to teach us what we need to overthrow them. Like that's our job now.
So literally what Asada tells us, right? That they're never going to give you the education to overthrow them. And don't be like embarrassed. Like they literally hide this from us, right? Like, it's not like you should have known. You shouldn't. It's a secret. They're afraid about what that type of power would provide you. I would say another quote, I would be quoting these women are incredible. You know, dreams and reality are opposites. Actions, you know, actions are what make it manifested. And so you have to take a deep dive into, you know, what we call political education. You have to look for it. Sometimes Google is your friend for basics. If you're looking into the history of, you know, anti-Blackness and incarceration. And I did drop, you know, because we're about a year out from the Black National Convention, which many of us participated in last year, and the policy demands made in that in 2020, which includes the end of war on Black people, political power, community control, reparations. And we do mean cut a check. We don't mean buy services, because y'all cut a check for everybody else, and defund and really essentially abolish the police, economic justice.
One thing I really wanted to add here, oh, I'm sorry, Kamisi, did you want to say something? Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, I was just going to say, in terms of like this question and the last question, with the last question, also, you know, power concedes nothing without demands, but also, like that quote is like a little bit off, right? Because like power concedes nothing without power. So if we don't hold the levers of power in society, then it doesn't matter, you know, what we do in terms of like unification if we're not taking those levers of power. Because at the end of the day, we get what we're organized to take, right? Because the ruling class will not relinquish anything to us unless it's, you know, as like a safety valve to keep them in power. But in terms of like this question, I think education is like twofold, right? You have like political ed, which is, you know, really like deeply like centered in like, you know, deepening and strengthening our own analysis and clarity. But then you also have the popular education model as well, which is more based in like storytelling, right? Like connecting, you know, our common struggle through dialogue and talking about our own lived experiences, which I think, especially like when we talk about areas primarily affected by the diaspora, right? The Caribbean, the United States, parts of South America, you have the same oppressors, right? They use the same tactics. It's the same people doing it. When you have these like conversations with people, you can't help but to like see the commonality in the struggle, right? Because we all don't have food on our plate, right? We are all facing like getting thrown out of our houses. We're all facing this like gigantic pandemic that's, you know, primarily affected Black, Brown, and Indigenous people across the global South, right? So I think these are like shared, like through that like dialogue, you can find shared points of struggle, which helps, you know, build that initial camaraderie, because at the end of the day, we need like an army of generals, not generals leading an army, right? And so really our responsibility doesn't just rely on education, but building the leadership that will continue to take over and build the movement after like we're out of these like positions of influence.
One more thing, and then I'll pass it back to you, Tia. Thank you for that, Khamisi. This is one of the complexities that I'm always trying to hold to, like working in a grassroots membership organization, is I believe that the most important and profound political education happens through the struggle, right? But the struggle has to be immediately connected to some material change. Like, yes, we want to abolish prisons, but so one of my ideas is, and I feel like a lot of people that I've encountered, especially in the last year, have been really critical of, like, you know, nonprofits and sort of fitting all nonprofits in the same boat as if they're all exactly the same. Nonprofit is simply a tax status for the to be recognized by this capital S state. That is all it is. Now, of course, there is a culture about nonprofits rooted in whiteness, heteropatriarchy, sexism, homophobia, all the things, right? All of that is true. And also, if we want to build movements which are about people, that can actually have the power, as you were saying before, that power concedes nothing without demand, without power. Movements are the things that get us there. And the only way to get there is with the people. And the people have, when they're in crisis, it's much harder to move somebody to action when they're in crisis, unless that action is going to help alleviate that crisis. So you have to use issue-based campaigns to alleviate the suffering of a group of people. So like I say, people in Brooklyn, and then use it as an opportunity to talk about Black feminist theories, to talk about all of these things. And then you generate a sort of like pipeline of the kind of people, the generals that Khamisi's naming. You know, we're not born that way necessarily. And I think that it's very important that we hold that complexity, because I feel like when we develop a revolutionary politic that doesn't account for the immediate concrete needs of individual people and the collective, and I mean this beyond mutual aid projects, like I think that we miss an opportunity to really have those kinds of conversations. Because if for me, here's where I'll end, like I'll take one person that I know for sure, Flower, 70-plus-year-old woman who was actually at the March on Washington, who's a member of Vocal New York, who was experiencing homelessness for 5 years. So if we were, as organizers who are trying to help build a movement to end homelessness, we would not be successful as organizers if we organized Flowers and Flowers got an apartment and then Flowers went home. But we're successful when we organize with Flowers to get Flowers an apartment. She gets that apartment, that's important. And then Flowers still comes out because she understands that ending homelessness is about dismantling capitalism, racism, and all of these things. Though she knew that before, but she, as an example, like that's what we have to be doing. And I think that's what Black Freedom Project is trying to do and should be doing. That's what I think Black August is reminding us of, that there's just this massive amount of energy that we can tap into to move people to action for a collective indifferent future. Tia.
Word, facts, Jawanza, preach. All right, so in case you didn't see it in the chat, I let folks know we're pretty much close to wrapping up. That was our last chunk of panel discussion before we did some announcements about the day of actions that are coming up on the 7th. But I would be remiss if I let this session end without making sure we gave space to talk directly to our non-Black allies. So our white folks, our non-Black folks, you know, we planned on having a little, you know, one-on-one chat with y'all about how y'all have shown up versus how you should show up, what we deserve and what we need from all of you in your role as allies. Because, you know, listen, fucking Mobb Deep said it best, ain't no such thing as halfway crooks. You either, I'm sorry, Nia's laughing because, you know, that's my favorite song since fucking elementary school. So I quote it all day, every day. but it's true though, ain't no such thing as halfway crooks. You either in it with us or you not. And so how does that show up in practice? What does that look like? What does it mean to like truly dismantle your anti-Blackness as well as hold your other motherfuckers accountable to dismantling their anti-Blackness? And what does it mean to be Black organizers who, you know, may not have the luck of landing in, you know, all Black organizing spaces? Some of us gotta like be all up in the like other spaces. And sometimes we're alone. Sometimes we might have one or two motherfuckers along with us. But the point is the shit get real in spaces that are not Black. Not saying that it don't get real in all Black spaces too, because we got our own house to clean up. But I can't let this end without touching on that. So if y'all are feeling the spirit and y'all want to hang on with us for another 5 or 10 minutes, I want to give space to the panelists to really touch on that as well and talk directly to all of you. And then after that, we'll wrap it up and announce the day of actions that are coming up. So I'm a leave it as like that open-ended thing. Whoever want to jump in and jump it off, pop it off, go ahead.
Well, I guess I'll say first is that we don't need allies, right? Allyship is inherently adjacent to the struggle, right? Race, again, is a tool of the capitalist class, right? They use it so that they can exploit white folks, right? Maybe a little bit less than they exploit Black folks, but just enough to keep that rift and division to exploit all of us, right? So if you see yourself as an ally, you see yourself as adjacent and not directly impacted by the same things that we are, right? Obviously in a completely different fashion, right? We experience like the brunt end of all of this, right? But at the same day, if you have an enslaved Black worker who's a blacksmith who can do this work for free because we're being exploited as chattel, you know, workers, why the fuck would they pay some white blacksmith a good wage to do the same work, right? Like y'all directly impacted by this shit too. So you need to stop seeing yourselves as adjacent and actually participate with us like side by side to dismantle all of these systems, not just like be here to like, I don't know, like donate money to Sean King or something. Like, I don't know. Shit that's like performative, you know what I'm saying?
That part, I mean, you see that part. I would say, one, release yourself from the shackles of respectability politics that some Black people deserve to be liberated and other folks don't because of the way they act or the way that they talk. Or where they live, so on and so forth. Two, non-Black people of color, you need to confront anti-Blackness because there is a reason why skin lightening creams are the largest beauty market throughout the colonized world. You understand, you know you're a person of color, you understand that you are not Black. You need to align your struggle with Black folks. White folks, saying you're anti-racist is not good enough. You have to do the work. And reparations is real and not in an ideological way. I mean, in a monetary, you need to give up money, power, and resources and stop infantilizing us in a way it's like, well, what are you doing with the $20 that I gave you? Because you give $20 to Red Cross and St. Jude and ask absolutely no questions. And when I say reparations, I do mean from every imperialist entity that ever engaged in chattel slavery, from the United States to the United Kingdom, Spain, France, Belgium, everyone is paying up. And it's not, I think y'all have this idea that it's just like magically coming from the government. Is you benefited from it. So it's coming from your bank account. You need to, I don't know if they got to increase y'all taxes or something, but you have to redistribute. No, in the United States, there's a 28-year wealth gap between Black American families and white folks in this country. There's a reason why a white GED student can excel in social mobility in a way that a Black person with a college degree cannot. It is an issue, and we are never going to catch up just by you being nice to us, to be having a Black friend, and stop being in this movement because you want brownie points for it. Be in it because we have to dismantle the atrocity which was stolen Indigenous land and global enslavement of Black folks.
Oh, one thing, I really appreciate all of that, Nia. And another thing, so now I'm thinking about coalitions and like sort of campaigns, but a lot of groups work on. And this is the thing with a lot of white folks I've learned is just because something is strategic politically for the campaign at that moment does not mean that it's not harmful ultimately for what it is that we're trying to do. Like I'm not talking about fundamental disagreements on like, you know, the best path forward for a campaign, but if you're sort of, or if you don't want to do something or you want to do something that is in direct conflict with a bigger narrative shift that needs to happen, because it might get the press there or it might actually get the bill passed. We got to really hold that. And that's a struggle that I have found in New York State and a lot of the statewide campaigns that I'm working on. I'm just like, that's not right. And here's why. And I saw that with defund. And I'm honestly really defeated. My spirit was defeated in a lot of ways that we went from 2020 to this year, the police, and not defunding the police in New York City. And then they got $300-400 million more than they had before. And I don't know how, I know how that happened, but it's just deeply disturbing. For instance, and I'll stop here, is this idea that defund the police is an inflammatory term. It is confusing and we shouldn't use it because it's not politically strategic. Well, if people can't get behind the idea of defunding and not abolishing the institution, how could they ever get to the place of where we need to be? So we need to stay strong and continue to say these kinds of things, because if we don't say them, then how will they ever happen?
Word. Anybody got any last thoughts on this before I move us?
The only thing I gotta say is this country don't give a fuck about us.
No.
And Nia gave me a flashback bringing up Daniel Prude, and when we were out here in Rochester literally getting our asses beat by the cops. I was like, there's nothing respectable about this movement. Don't expect me to be respectable. If you catch hands, you catch hands, and that's it.
Facts. All right, so I'm gonna move us into the announcements for the Black August Day of Actions, which is on August 7th. Before I do that, I gotta give appreciations one more time, because y'all niggas were lit tonight. And I truly appreciate every single one of you for making the time to be on here, for all the knowledge and wisdom you dropped. It's been a beautiful experience for the last hour and a half. I'm not going to front and I'm not going to tear up. I really appreciate y'all. This has been beautiful. There's so many gems. Folks, participants who are still on, we'll make sure to follow up with the recording if you want to watch it again or send it to other folks. And just real quick on the whole, the role of non-Black folks, I'm co-signing on everything that's already been said. But if that shit felt overwhelming to you and you want some real little tangible shit you could do, I'll say this. Don't be that motherfucker who come up to a Black person after a meeting on the side in secret and be like, yo, that was fucked up that they ignored what you said, or that was fucked up that they gaslit you, or, I feel you, sis. No. If you didn't speak up when everybody was in the room around the table, I don't want to hear nothing you got to say to me right now. So if you can't do all the things that everybody listed, the least that you could do is show up and say some shit and call some shit out to your people when it happened. Because sometimes either we don't feel safe to speak up, or it's one of those things, it's like, motherfucker, I'm so exhausted from this bullshit and all the work it does to organize and work with my people. I just don't have the time and energy to engage, because I know if I say something, it might not even go nowhere, and then I'm more frustrated. That's some little shit you could do. Just
hold use your privilege.
Use your shit.
And you have to be comfortable with having uncomfortable conversations. Work. And the fact that you've been under racial capitalism, you benefit from the fact that you're not Black, right?
Listen, I'm sorry. We've been uncomfortable and then some since 1619, okay? So you'll be
since
all right.
Before them, from 1492. And if we want to talk about our enslavement throughout the Arab Peninsula, 600 years before that as well.
Listen, we've been uncomfortable. We've been oppressed. We've been violently, shut down. Listen, you can handle it. Trust me. Your delicate sensibilities is all in your head. You can handle it. And we've done some magic with that. Blackness is fucking magic. So on that note, I'm gonna share my screen one more time to announce these days of actions that are happening in various parts of New York State. I'm gonna give everyone a few minutes. The link is up here. Saye is gonna throw the link in the chat. So if you go to blackaugustny.com, you'll get more details around all the actions that are happening across New York State on the 7th, which is in 2 days. And so, you know, this Black August Day of Actions across New York State is in direct response to opposing the police reform proposals that Governor Cuomo threw down on local departments and police unions, et cetera. So we're like, no, 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 we don't need that. We don't wanna see that. Like, we got our own plans. So we wanna make sure that we're prioritizing and promoting abolition and alternatives to policing. We don't need the police to be telling us what they're gonna do next, you know? So it's real important if you're in any of these cities. So I think, hold on, let me go over to the roster, the next page. So if you're in any of these cities, so in Binghamton, Ithaca, Oneonta, I don't even know if I pronounced that right, Albany, Saratoga, and Rochester. And if you go on the website, there may be other cities that have been added on since I created these slides. But if you're in any of these cities or close to them, definitely, you know, throw down on these days of actions. I'm gonna leave this up and let folks take a few minutes to look at the information, you know, click on the link. I'll play some music right now. But that's it for tonight. We're done. It's been a beautiful experience. We'll make sure to follow up in an email with recordings. We're gonna send this recording as well as additional readings and resources for folks who wanna learn more or really dig deeper into, you know, some of the things that we touched on tonight. And with that, I can shut up and just let the music play.
Thank you so much, Tia, for coordinating this. Like, special appreciation to Tia and Saye, who did so much work in the background.
Listen,
y'all don't know about how Black women be holding us down.
Facts. Y'all give me energy. Y'all listen, y'all fed me tonight.
When everything goes wrong, you see somewhere. Whose intentions are good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood. You know, sometimes, baby, I'm so carefree. Through the joy, it's hard to find. And then sometimes again it seems that all I have is worry. And then you're bound to see my other side. But I'm just the soul's intentions of good. Oh Lord, please don't let me be misunderstood. I want you to know I'm never meaning to take it out on me.
That's all we have for y'all tonight. Y'all go home.